Boker Tov, good morning. Today is Friday, June 18th, Erev Shabbat Parshat Chukat. Tuesday night was a special night. It was a special night for many of the parents in our school, in our shul, whose kids graduated from Westchester Day School. Monday night was also a great night and great afternoon as graduates from SAR, and I'm sure the other schools as well. I don't know the dates specifically of their graduations. That was all fantastic, but I'm referring to the fact that on Tuesday night there were fireworks that were set off, not the 4th of July, but rather to mark the fact that New York had hit an important milestone. 70% of New Yorkers, adult New Yorkers, had been vaccinated, and New York is opening up. That's the message. And most of those rules that had been set into place over time or immediately, and then in other ways, further restrictions around COVID, were going to be eased. It's a great moment of celebration. And yet, I think that for many of us, even those of us who have started to participate in things, it's still uneasy for us. We still feel odd in certain settings. Baruch Hashem, if you've been out to our outdoor minyanim, that feels okay. But indoors, sometimes we get a little more anxious if we're in a space without masks with people. And that's something which is natural. And I would suggest we should look back to the story in our parsha to understand it a little bit more. What story am I referring to? The story, of the people thirsting for water, not having water, complaining about that to Moshe and Aaron. Moshe comes, we know the story, hit the rock, and Moshe and Aaron eventually are punished for how they act there. But what is the story about? Why is it they don't have water? So if any of you who are in my Chumash class this past week, we talked about sort of the miraculous water source that comes from Miriam that had been providing water for them, and with Miriam's death, she dies, and so it shuts off. But how do you understand that shut off of the water? And here I would suggest that we take the wisdom of the Netziv in his commentary, Hamek Davar, to heart. And Netziv really has an understanding that what is critical for the Israelites is a transition that they need to make. And it's a transition which actually is reversing the initial transition. And each of the moments of the transition, or periods of transition, have carried with them great angst and indeed some foment and trouble that is associated with it. And so the stories of manna and water, in certain ways, are bookends of this. We know that people are thirsting for water. Back in Bishalach, they're thirsty, they're hungry for food, and God provides them man, and God provides them miraculous water. And in that story, though, they are upset, and they seem to be, as God calls, ultimately is referred to as a place of Maso Meriva. It's where the people are indeed in a dispute with God, and a testing God. And says the Netziv how to understand that, and we all understand, right, it's significantly clear to us how we understand that. They are moving from a natural order where you have food because you have it in your pack, but after a month they ran out of food, and you have water because there are water sources all around, and suddenly those water sources aren't there. And if we're going to survive in a desert, even for a number of months, which was the original plan, right, we're going to need miraculous assistance. And that is what happens there, and that's not easy for people. That we're going to have to shift from the normal way we lead our lives to something which is unusual, different, and requires a great deal of faith, and at the same time, discomfort with that reality. but then they settle into it. So there is angst, and even we'll call it rebellion, that happens initially at the beginning of the Midbar story, back in Bishalach, all the way in Exodus, and then they settle into that. And that goes on, unfortunately, for more than a year, and it goes on for 40 years. And here we arrive in Parshat Chukat, and suddenly it's the 40th year, and God wants to make another transition. Listen to these words of the Netziv. Avor ledat debishana hachrona haya sof halichot hanisiyi b'anhaga nifla'a ha'olech yamin Moshe zrot tiferet Hashem. you should understand, it's important that people should understand that in this last year, it was the end of their journey in life, and in desert and in life, which was by nace, which was by non-natural, supernatural assistance, with some higher oversight on God's part. And now they are just at the precipice; they're ready to enter the land of Israel and to have to shift into natural order with under God's oversight. So it's still, with blessed, but it's going to have to shift to the miraculous, from the miraculous to the derech hateva, to the world of nature. Al kenit nahega kadosh baruch hu imam. He seems to say God goes easy on the people when they complain here, and he describes. And it's sort of a middle ground. I'm sorry. There is an easing that happens here, and he describes it to the attempt to slowly wean a child from nursing to whole food, and that even as point we're gonna shift completely. Let's say the mother's gonna shift completely at a certain point, a certain juncture. She'll start already a month or two earlier, trying to provide food and solid food in different ways to the child. Again, our patterns might be different than he describes here. And nursing will continue a little bit and along with it, but you're going to try to introduce food so that you can make a transition when you need to make the transition. And that's what's happening here. And so what God did here, it's not merely that, oh, Miriam died and in the merit of Miriam no longer stood for them. This is the moment when God says, I'm preparing you. I'm preparing you to re-enter normal living where you have food that you pick or you create and cook and produce, and you have water that you gain from water sources, and that's how people naturally live. And this is hard. This too created an angst. He has another developing idea that goes on here about the difference between the spiritual elites and the common folk and what they're ready to do and not ready to do. But the essential point is this, that just as it was hard for people to kind of let go of normal life and to enter miraculous life, it's hard for people to leave miraculous living, where it's gotten safe, and re-enter normal life. And that's what, of course, we know has been happening in this country over the past few months. At least for people who have taken the right precautions and have gotten themselves vaccinated, they're able to do so. Even with all that, it's not merely that, okay, right? Yesterday we were locked up in our houses. Today we do everything. Today I'm in a crowded theater with people. It's not exactly going to work that way. Not only in terms of, rules that are slowly easing, but in the way of our own psychology, people have to regain comfort step by step back into normal living. We have outdoor tefillah without masks, and I think that for people who haven't yet come the first time you're there, and certainly those who are who are very cautious, it feels odd, and then it will get easier. And indoor minyan as well is going to be that way, as Temple Israel Center has a set of rules that'll be there right now. In our partnership with the Young Israel, we are indoors without masks at this point for those who are vaccinated. And that first time, it was both relieving and awkward. And I went into the bakery today to go into the back of the bakery and do my shkacha work. And the person behind the counter said, "Oh, Rabbi, you're not wearing a mask." And I said, "Right. I'm not wearing a mask because it's just the transition point that we all have to get ourselves comfortable." Hopefully, it's not filled with the uprising angst, right, that we have in the parasha. But the psychology is still the same. And we want to be here for you. We in the shul want to be here for you to help you have that easing into the world that is community and normal life that was meant to be lived. I wouldn't call what we've had this past year as miraculous life, but it's sort of non-natural, back into the natural world we want to be in, where we can be together, hug each other, daven with one another, share food together, and create all that is worth it in a community and beyond. So let's take the wisdom of the Netziv and self-awareness that it provides, self-awareness and other awareness, help each other along as we indeed transition ourselves back to where we want to be, and actually in a better way, as we'll be talking over the course of the next few months about what our tzibur will be, not simply returning, but actually to create that which we hope to create in the best way that we can. Have a Shabbat Shalom.